Você já passou por isso? Conhece alguém que esteja passando? Se você já sofreu alguma violência na internet, não sabe o que fazer nem como denunciar, nós podemos ajudar. A Safernet oferece um canal gratuito de orientação e apoio, além de explicar o passo a passo de como denunciar crimes na internet. Você será atendido por um profissional, com respeito, anonimato e estrito sigilo sobre tudo o que for dito. Juntos, vamos fazer da internet um ambiente mais seguro, onde todos possam exercer sua liberdade com responsabilidade e respeito. Entre em contato com a gente, estamos prontos para te ajudar. Helpline Safernet. Navegar com liberdade é navegar com segurança.
Já imaginou se você não tivesse seu direito à liberdade de expressão respeitado? Se seus dados particulares fossem divulgados sem autorização? Ou se você tivesse sua navegação filtrada por causa de interesses comerciais? A liberdade de expressão, a privacidade e a neutralidade da rede são fundamentais para a internet. E esses são apenas alguns dos 10 princípios formulados pelo Comitê Gestor da Internet no Brasil. O CGI.br promove há mais de 20 anos a internet no país. Graças a ele, você tem constante inovação, segurança e diretrizes para o desenvolvimento da internet. Isso tudo é feito de forma colaborativa, transparente e democrática. O comitê é formado por representantes de todos os setores da sociedade. Assim, as decisões são tomadas por meio do diálogo, com a participação de todos os membros, até que um consenso seja alcançado. Por esses e outros fatores, o modelo brasileiro de governança se tornou referência no mundo todo. CGI.br, por uma internet cada vez melhor no Brasil.
Quando você registra um domínio .br, você está contribuindo para a melhoria da internet no Brasil. Pois cada domínio que usa o .br é registrado pelo NIC.br, o Núcleo de Informação e Coordenação do .br, que além de registros de nomes de domínios, investe em análise e tratamento de incidentes de segurança, projetos de tecnologias de redes e operações, pesquisas que trazem indicadores sobre o uso das tecnologias da informação e comunicação, implementação de pontos de troca de tráfego local na internet, projetos que contribuem no desenvolvimento global da web e muito mais. Tudo isso porque o NIC.br é uma entidade civil de direito privado e sem fins lucrativos, que mantém uma estrutura de registro de domínio segura, estável e de confiança, e reverte parte do que você paga pelo seu domínio no desenvolvimento de infraestrutura, trazendo benefícios para todos que usam a internet no Brasil. Toda essa inovação, tecnologia de ponta, segurança e infraestrutura só é possível porque você tem um domínio .br. NIC.br, sempre em busca do melhor para a nossa internet.
One day, humankind created a wonderful tool. The computer. Innovation followed its course, and the internet was born. One of the greatest inventions, the power at your fingertips to learn, play, connect, interact, create, and share. A universal access, connecting the world. Unfortunately, there is a flip side to everything. Cybercrime, illegal content, including the worst of the worst area. Online child sexual abuse. Child victims need protection. Offenders need to be brought to justice. And you, the digital citizens, need to know you are not powerless. This is why the In Hope Network was born. Through a hotline, you can anonymously report any images and videos you suspect are illegal. Each report is thoroughly assessed by qualified analysts and legal experts. If it is confirmed as illegal, it will be notified to law enforcement and internet service providers. The content will be removed from public access, and those responsible shall be prosecuted. InHope member hotlines cooperate daily with international counterparts to to decrease the availability of such material. In Hope helps make the internet a better and safer place, worthy of the finest inventions of humankind. Your report matters. Help us make a difference. Report it. Don't ignore it.
O perfil é meu e eu faço o que eu quiser. Provavelmente você já ouviu essa frase e é por isso que as empresas de tecnologia precisam investir em mais campanhas para a galera ficar ciente de valores sociais e legais nas redes sociais.
Eu gostaria que o acesso à internet fosse um direito garantido pelo governo.
Precisamos de uma educação altamente eficaz que capacite as pessoas a viverem coletivamente na internet.
Que as escolas promovam um debate aberto, atualizado e contínuo sobre o uso da internet.
Que a checagem de informações seja uma prática diária de todos os brasileiros, encorajada principalmente por políticas públicas de educação.
Eu quero que as universidades públicas se comprometam com o debate sobre cidadania digital através do seu tripé acadêmico de pesquisa, ensino e extensão.
Eu quero mais pessoas LGBTs, negras, indígenas e quilombolas pensando política pública digital.
A minha proposta é que outros jovens indígenas possam ter essa mesma oportunidade que eu tive de ocupar espaços como este no Cidadão Digital, na Safernet, para falar sobre sua identidade, suas lutas e direitos.
Que a juventude possa ter um comprometimento ético e crítico sobre o uso que faz da internet.
Muito bom dia. Muito bom dia. Bom dia a todos.
Good morning to all of you. Welcome. Welcome to our 15th Brazilian edition of the Safe Internet Day. This is an event that has been taking place for a while, since 2009, in partnership with CGI, and thanks to the coordination of NIC.br, which has been here represented by the father of internet in Brazil, Professor Demi Guedes, who is also the executive director for NIC.br. And we have Google, YouTube, TikTok, Meta, Vivo, as our sponsors, and we have institutional partnership since the first edition of the Federal Public Ministry. And I am so glad to have Priscila Costa Schneider, who is here representing the Federal Ministry, and she's been participating since the very first edition. We also have here Internet Society, UNICEF Brazil, Abranet, the Association of Childhood Brazil, Febraban. We have the Sanctuary of the Redemption Christ. And the Redemption Christ will be lighted next Friday with our colors to celebrate this special event. And we have as media supporters, the Cultura Television, Global Television, and Wall for their support to communicate and advertise our event. This is an initiative which was raised in Europe in 2004. Two networks which have been working for over 20 years to guarantee users' security in the European continent. Thanks to the European Commission support, and now that has been expanded, and there are over 50 countries participating and been mobilized to celebrate a safe internet. And we Brazilians have been celebrating that for 10 years, and Europeans for 20 years. And after a couple of years celebrating that day remotely due to the pandemics, now we are here celebrating over this hybrid format to discuss about digital citizenship. From a multi-stakeholder perspective, which has always been a peculiarity as part of our event, we are going to have 26 panelists, 17 ladies and 9 men. So we have a very strong female participation. 20 Brazilian speakers and 6 foreigners from Kenya, Thailand, UK, US. And I'm pretty sure that the richness and diversity of different experiences and culture will help us to advance, to better face our challenges. Thank you to all of those who have accepted our invitation to be speakers. There are another 46 decentralized events which are taking place all over Brazilian cities, 36 distributed in 17 states. And we have 15 youngsters participating here today as writers. They are representing different foundations from north to south to our country, and they are here to collaborate and to share diversity and their potential to make best use of digital citizenship, representing different areas from the main hub, São Paulo and Rio de Janeiro. In 2022, we registered an increase of 68% of hate denounces in the internet, and hate crimes, they keep growing. Last year, xenophobia has shown an increase of 44% and 456% increase in religious hate and several messages of hate, harassment to women. 2022 was our third consecutive electoral year where hate speech, they showed an increase, and that has been registered by Safernet since 2008. And we see a steady increase, a resilient increase for a while. Those cases regarding childhood abuse, we have over 100,000 reports. Last year, 101,000 reports of sexual abuse with adolescents and children. That represents 9.9% increase. If on one hand, we share democracy in Brazil, on the other hand, we see hate becoming materialized and destroying attacks that took place by extremists in the last January 8th at our federal capital. democratic responses, they have to be very strong, and also they have to be proportional, and we have to be careful about fundamental human rights, such as freedom of expression, citizens' freedom within the digital realm in accordance to the legal, internet legal framework, which has a key role in the 10 chapters that were responsible to establish the base of our regulatory aspects. Overall, GDPR. 2023, I'm pretty sure that we'll need to create a new multi-stakeholder consensus where we'll have to moderate different content in Portuguese based on hate speech and harmful guidance. Conversely, we have to control the balance that will allow the state to guarantee our law and order. We can no longer accept governmental hacking actions, incentives to backdoor and cryptography, storage of vulnerabilities of agencies, and also to banalize spies and spy devices and surveillance against citizens, including human rights activists and journalists, leakage of personal data, and persistence to failures of design of digital products that may harm citizens' privacy, mainly children and adolescents. These are not simple aspects. They are so complex, and we have to go after building up consensus. And those can just be possible if we work under collaboration, where there is dialogue and respect to different perspectives, where there is a good faith among all players. Safernet is willing to emphasize and empower our multi-stakeholder approach, collaborating for a decision-making process based on evidences. On a post-pandemic environment, evidences, they are key to underline any future decision. And in the digital environment, that is also the case. I'd like here to pay a homage to the memory and legacy of Danilo Donedo, who unfortunately passed away 2 months ago. He was a speaker in the 2018 and 2020 edition of Safer Day. As a great professor, lawyer, prosecutor, Danilo Donedo was acknowledged as one of expert in data protection. CGI.br, after he passed away, on a note, has emphasized that Danilo Donedo was always after consensus. He was a consensus advocate. We hope that his legacy keeps on inspiring us in that consensus journey to guarantee a safer internet. We'll have a chance to go into details about some more data in our second table. And with no further ado, I'd like now to give the floor to our guests, our panelists, for their opening remarks. Professor Demi, who is the director of NIC.br, and he's responsible for this event. Thank you. Good morning to all of you. Tiago, you were very timely with your words and comments. Some overall comments. NIC.br, in addition to Safernet, we have no direct involvement with content. However, CERT department addresses any malicious contents or those which are not well intended, such as security and safety attacks, DNS control. So they get reports from a content aspect, and we try to develop best practices to guide better behaviors throughout the network somehow to protect our users. Well, the name of this event is Safer Internet, a safer net. To be 100% safe, forget about that. Any tool that we may deploy, they are not 100% safe. What makes them safe is how you deploy them. So to have 100% safe internet, that is quite a utopic. But the best or the safer use of the internet, that is so important. And we have so many manuals and guides that may help you to make a better and safer use of the internet, not to disclose your personal information in addition to .br, a collection of best practices that may guide our users. In addition to that, Brazil is well seen from internet perspective. And why is that? Well, we have 5 million domains which have that were reached last year, and we just allow domains for those that have a CPF or a CNPJ. We are closed to, so we work with mainly within the Brazilian region, and the Brazilian legislation, our GDPR was well seen, the CGI, which was at the beginning of our legal civil mark. And from my own perspective, this is a main aspect that works as a guiding principle that was well discussed by GDPR. However, I see that there is a gap from a taxonomy aspect. If you deploy the proper taxonomy, yet you'll be able to deploy everything that you see in the legal civil mark. When it is said that it's not responsible for what it takes, that is a fact. No one will make a postman liable for a letter with an inappropriate content. What could be improved, though, it's a better reasoning about the taxonomy and how can we define that content in a less vague way. Otherwise, we will punish different players in the sector, and we may end up hindering internet as whole. So internet safety is a mobile tool, as there are always new ways to generate a different sort of attacks, but yet we have to be always alert and try to minimize as much as possible or give to our users additional resources to defend themselves from an environment which is becoming more and more sophisticated with minor details that can be really harmful. So I wish you all a very fruitful day. Once again, congratulations for our 15th edition, and let's hand over now to our next guest. Thank you, Demi, Dr. Priscila. You have the floor now. Thank you. Good morning to all of you. I am so happy to be once again participating at this event, which I consider to be one of the most important events worldwide speaking from internet safety and digital safety. I haven't greeted my other dear panelists. I wish you all a great and fruitful day. The Day of Safe Internet, it's an important one, and I'm glad to be here representing the Public Prosecutor's Office. This is an event to all of us which allows collaboration, cooperation, dialogue, and not only to have a safer internet, but with more dignity. I'm representing the Federal Public Prosecutor's Office. And let me share a little bit of our background. I am a current Republic Prosecutor Office, and I was for very long a prosecutor in the city of São Paulo. Now I'm moving to Brasília, our federal capital. And I am a participant at a cybernetic attacks from the Federal Prosecutor's Office. Since 2003, we are becoming experts as how we can improve and how we can defeat criminality, cybernetic crimes, cyber crimes. And we learned that the best way to defeat cyber crimes is throughout prevention. We have around 20 years partnership with Rodrigo from Safernet, where a number of programs were designed in collaboration with Safernet, in collaboration with the Public Prosecutor Office, in collaboration with CGI, where we can raise a digital awareness. Internet safety is utopia, but it's not a utopic to have a safer internet. In 2003, when the first group from the Federal Prosecutor Office was created, I remember Tiago introducing a number of issues that were becoming a problem from a children pornography perspective. And that became even worse as time went by. And thanks to a partnership with Google and in collaboration with the Public Prosecutor Office and Safernet, a safer environment was fostered. And I'm glad to know that companies, they have been careful regarding prevention, to avoid discrimination, and collaboration not only with the Public Prosecutor Office. And in the legal setting, we say that against the facts, there is no argument. And I say that in the internet environment, against evidence, there is no escape. There are entities that are careful for innovations. 2003, that is quite prehistorical in relation to internet. But yet, since then, many new technologies, such as AI, Internet of Things. And with that, I say that the public prosecutor office is careful for innovation. We have courses that enable different professionals. I have a group that enables all members of the public ministry as well as prosecutors to help to put a halt in this kind of crimes. We have a collaboration which today is formal, official. Now with Safernet, we get a number of reports at Safernet. We have the federal police participation. We want to become more modern because the crimes, they are modern, they become more advanced. And the Federal Prosecutor's Office, thanks to partnership and collaboration with the internet providers, where we can better learn one from another, we are very careful. Since that Google's partnership was signed, that has improved. In addition, we always had a digital program in partnership with Safernet. That was a huge program fostering prevention, how to better defeat it. The number of report violations, they are increasing, as well as the number of innovation and search for new technology, they are increasing. And that is increasing because there is a better communication channel between citizenship at a Safernet website, at our public prosecutor's office. In addition to that, we have new technologies which may help us to go after violations. So I cannot stress enough, internet is not a setting which has no law. So internet crimes, they leave their trace, and there is no way to escape from it. Prevention is the best way to advocate and to defeat reported violation. So count on us. We have been participating for the last 15 editions, and we hope we can keep on participating in the next 10, 20, 50 years, counting on technology, holograms. And to close and conclude, I would like to welcome you all and once again to share all my joy to be here. I am at your total disposal if you'd like to hear more about what we do at the Federal Prosecutor's Office. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Priscilla Schreiner. We are also very proud of the partnership we have with the prosecutor's office. And these are partnerships. This is one characteristic of Safernet and of NIC.br. These are long-lasting partnerships. And the best evidence of that is our 15th edition of the Internet Safe Internet Day and having the prosecutor's office with us right from the beginning. And thinking about long-lasting partnerships, let me invite Flavia. She represents Google in Brazil, the first company to believe in this proposal. And starting supporting the event 7 or 8 years ago, it was in 2015, if I'm not mistaken. Flavia? Thank you, Tiago. I would like to start by greeting my fellow panelists. It's really an honor to be part of this opening panel. I would also like to thank and congratulate Safernet, CGI, NIC.br for putting together this day of activity. I was last year part of this event in the virtual module, and I'm glad to be here in the hybrid format of this year. It's an honor for me and for Google to be part of this initiative. which is really a long-lasting partnership that we've had in place with Safernet. Usually on this Safe Internet Day, we try to recall all our efforts concerning online security and also to share some big news with you. Let me start by sharing some data that shows what Google has been doing in this mission of making internet a safer place. It is safer. It's important to use this terminology, not safe, but safer. Google every day tries to detect 40 billion pages of spam in Google search, check 1 billion passwords to obtain really any password mistakes, and protect 1.5 billion users of Gmail, blocking 99.9% of spam, malware, and phishing attempts. In addition, there is also a manual. It's part of the material that has been distributed, which gives some easy, safe hints, can be followed by anyone, and I would like to highlight a few of them. So two-stage verification, which goes beyond the password, Gmail, which has a number of filters that block spam, phishing, and malware attempt, 10 million emails blocking every single minute. You've probably seen that message with a warning. And the same applies at Chrome with some information about a cheating site or misleading site. There are also some hints on how to create strong passwords and QR codes that can be used to go into the URL where we can have safe information for end users, just telling about the activation of different safety tools and activating those which are not enabled yet. This is by user. I would also like to tell you that Google is expanding further its protection against spam in Google Drive. We are going to launch in a beta version, a new visualization of the drive in the content described as spam, similar to what we have at Gmail. Let me also tell you about the priority that we give to children and adolescents and the use of our platforms. We know it's a priority. We need a safe environment for children and their families. So we've invested significantly in the creation of different experiences for different age ranges and the creation of tools that would provide family to manage the use of technology at home. So these are some new initiatives and tools. First, we have a new configuration of Safer Search. We are going to launch a new protection to help families manage the access to explicit image in the search. It has been activated by default for users younger than 18, but with the new setup, the explicit image will be blurred when they come in the search result as default, really, even if Safer Search is not activated. We are also launching a new playlist in the YouTube with a number of hints on how to safely surf the web, so providing education content about use of technology and how families can talk about that, screen time, and a number of other topics. And another important approach, which is learning by playing. There are new tools, and I'm glad to tell you, they are tools for parents and teachers, and it helps teach children about online safety and the importance of protecting personal data. It is a partnership with Mauricio de Souza Production. We created a special edition of a Brazilian cartoon called Clube da Mônica. So there are games, short stories, hints, and other parental control tools, such as Family Link, that helps parents monitor online activity of their children. Today, we are going to hear from Alana Rizzo from YouTube, who is going to be a moderator of the opening talk. Then we have Giovanna Renteri with the legal department, who is going to tell us about the privacy checkup and some other creative initiatives to reach other publics with difficult topics such as data protection and safety. So I'm really glad to be here. I wish we all a wonderful event. Thank you for the invitation. Well, thank you, Flavia. The commitment of Google has also been long-term, and the announcements that you have just made really shows us that it is a permanent mission of all of us. New investments in safety features, this is something that we keep on needing, and which is constant. Let me now invite Mac, who is the public policy manager of Meta in Brazil, also a long-term partner of ours, and I'm sure that Meta will also share with us some news. So, Mac, thank you very much, Safernet, for the invitation to be here with you today, to be here, such a special place, NIC.br. Not NIC.br, main office. I think it's important to look to the past and celebrate what we've achieved. There is a whole community working for the safe of internet, as Tiago pointed out. We have to think about our current position. We've been talking about safe internet, and we have to together build and reach a consensus on what we want for the future. I've also done my homework.
Recording stopped.
Safety for Meta is one of our main pillars. So since 2018, our
recording
integrity
in progress
and security team comprises 40,000 people. In 2021 alone, we invested over $5 billion in those initiatives, not only bringing more qualified people, training them, but also investing in technology. We should use technology, AI, which brings us more efficiency and provide a safer, large-scale platform to all the community. Context and language are equally important in our opinion. There are many Brazilians working in these teams. Just for you to have an idea how it works, I brought you an example, very short example of our team. In our safety and security team, there are some safety engineers responsible for product architecture. There are some specialists and a whole intelligence team that traces authors which may bring threats to the system. We have a team of integrity which identifies abusive content and use machine learning to enhance the reach of the work that they do. We have a support team that helps us mitigate everyday risks and a number of other teams, and I'm part of one of them. As Demi pointed, and I liked what he said, internet safety is something in transition, constantly in move. And what have we planned for 2023 so far? In addition to constant improvement of our products and our policies and constant updates, in 2023, we want to really go further into three levels. First, by providing new protection. Secondly, new educational measures. And third, by providing additional support. New protections are new tools and features and updates. Everything focused on safety. In terms of education, it is known that there are many tools available to users, but many of them do not know about them. So educating on available tools, educating on tools that will be implemented more information about the rules and our commitment is something important, because the users can expect that from us and they don't even know that. And finally, support. Many people need support, and we always try to enhance the support provided to our users. So this is an overview of our plans for 2023, giving you a spoiler. In the afternoon, we are also going to hear from my teamwork, so Thais Mega from Safety and Ariel Durigan from WhatsApp. They are going to speak now in the afternoon about that, and I would like to invite you all to join us. Thank you all very much. Thank you. And as our last panelist, I would like to invite Priscila Laterza from TikTok. Hello, everyone. Good morning. It's a great honor to be here. Thank you very much, Safernet, for this wonderful invitation. Safernet, which is a great partner of TikTok, and it has been so since 2020. TikTok is a very new platform, which brings new things concerning safety, and it always sees as being very positive to have an event such as this, in which we have opportunities to celebrate our achievements, think further, and plan our future. Opportunities such as this, which are multidisciplinary, are extremely important because together we can come up with the best solutions considering technology, speaking of regulation, possible initiatives for the future, and that can only be done by thinking all together. It's wonderful to be here. I'm really honored to be part of this event for the first time, not TikTok's first time, but my first time. I am the public policy manager of TikTok, specialist in safety and security in the platform. And it's been quite interesting. I've been building a path towards improvement, but always together. We think about solutions, but really considering the interactions with specialists. Always being open to listen to specialists so that we can really offer safe internet. We have the Security Council of TikTok in Brazil, which helps us constantly improve our policies. We also have partners such as Safernet, Jimmy Cuida, UNICEF, and a number of other partners, which are instrumental and helps us come up with campaigns, educational initiatives that are very interesting campaigns related with the users' education on tools and screen time control, family management time. So tools which users, as Margaret pointed out, users are not really knowledgeable about them. They don't know how to use them. But if they had, they would have better quality time at the internet. I'll be also here in the afternoon. This is just a brief welcoming remarks to reinforce my gratitude and such an honor to be here with you. Thank you all very much. Have a great day. Thank you, Priscila. Well, I would like now to invite our friends and peers to sit in the auditorium, because now we are going to start for the next panel for the speaker of our keynote, who is here online with us. I would like to invite to be the moderator of the session, Alana Rizzo. She is a journalist and manager of public policy and governmental relations of YouTube. Alana, please welcome. Thank you very much for being here with us. And I would also like to greet and to give my welcome to Professor Jessica Taylor Pietrovich. Jessica is based in Amsterdam. She is a professor and researcher of the University of Amsterdam, where she leads Communication in Digital Society Chair. She is the director of the Research Center about Children, Adolescent, and Media, and former president of the Division of Children, Adolescent, and Media of the National Association of Communication. She is definitely one of the most respected researchers in the area. She publishes a lot of papers on the topics of the use of technology by children and adolescents. And for us in Safernet Brazil, it is a great honor to have Professor Pietrovski with us today as our keynote speaker for the 15th then day. Thank you very much, Jessica.
And I'm very happy to have you here. And I would like to invite Alana Rizzo to moderate the session. And thank you again, Alana, for your kind support.
Obrigada, Thiago. Bom dia a todos e a todas. Eu sei que a gente está com o horário super apertado.
Thank you, everyone. I know that we are running really tight with our time. So there is simultaneous translation. You may get the devices if you are in presence, or you may follow by YouTube. Jessica, I will hand over to you very quick. Welcome. It's a great honor to have you here with us today, and I'm very curious to hear you. You have the floor.
Jessica, and if you hear us, could you please say hi? Oh, thank you.
Hello, can you hear me okay?
Yes, perfectly.
Excellent. Can you see my slides?
Yes. Excellent. Thank you so much.
Okay, then, so I will get started. It's good to know that, hi, Tiago. It's good to see you digitally again. Tiago and I are good buddies. I will make this a bit shorter today because I am actually running to another meeting, but when Tiago asked me to speak, I could not say no to a dear friend. So I was asked to speak a little bit about what this idea of growing up digital means today. And to be honest, I'm not quite sure I know what it means. But what I do know is that we are seeing significant changes in what's happening globally. So for example, we are seeing that media use by tweens, so let's talk about our kids between 8 to 12 years old, or teenagers, so our 13 to 18 year olds, has grown faster in the past 2 years since the pandemic than it did 4 years before. Something is changing. And one of the questions we are asking is, well, what are they doing? And what we see globally is that kids are spending more time watching videos, primarily online, and spending more time gaming. And they're spending less time connecting with their friends. And this is what we see happening in countries around the world. And we see this really interesting, it says the co-host has asked me to start my video. Can you still hear me okay?
Yes.
Are we good?
Please.
Okay, so I got an alert on my end. So we see this sort of change happening. And the question is, what's going on? And should we be concerned? Now, one of the big questions that you hear people asking in this digital space where we're seeing more time spent online and really an exacerbation, really this exponential change, is what could it be replacing? Is it replacing playtime? Is it replacing time reading? Maybe time with family? Is it replacing time sleeping? We see, for example, that there's some data that suggests that young people today are sleeping 1 hour less per night. They're going to bed at the same time, but they're spending nearly an hour on their smartphone devices, sort of using their devices before they fall asleep. So these are real concerns we have. And what we hear when these concerns come up is parents, practitioners, individuals such as yourself in the audience today are often concerned about things such as, are they coming in contact with pornography? Self-harm content, content about disordered eating. Is there something happening with fear of missing out or what we might consider social comparison where they're looking at others and thinking, could I be better? Should I be better? And also what we saw really take hold, especially during the COVID pandemic, was misinformation. And really this dialogue about what should we be worried about with all of these time spent in digital spaces? Now, on the other hand, an optimistic person, and Tiago will tell you, I am one of those, might ask about what they could be doing, because this one side, this are they engaging in all of this negative things, is really a lens of what some might consider a very protected child. Things that we are very worried about in the digital space and things that we talk about at the Safer Internet Days, like, what are we worried? But on the other hand, there is this other side of the coin, right? There is this idea that yes, this digital space brings with us these concerns, but we also know that there's other things that it could be helping. Data is suggesting that it can help them with their friendship formation. Data is suggesting that the digital space can help them with creativity. Data is suggesting that it can help them in schools. A few months ago, I went to a festival here in the Netherlands where I live, and they were really bringing about some of the newest technology we see in the digital spaces. And we saw young children fully interacting and engaging in spaces, creating three-dimensional worlds, engaging in these beautiful digital art spaces, practicing their mathematical skills, their spatial skills, their reasoning skills, their creative skills in really beautiful ways. And so as much as those concerns are warranted, are valid, there is another side, right? There's also the side of what are they doing that could be beautiful and empowering. And we call this side the empowered child perspective. And in my research, and when I've studied sort of in history, how we as scholars think about young people, you often see this dilemma of, are you considering the child the protected child, or are you considering the child the empowered child? When a young child says to you, I did YouTube this morning, and Ukraine war live footage is all over that app, are you worried about what they're seeing about the war? Or are you viewing it as an opportunity to talk to them about what's happening and thinking about a way to help them process those messages? Are you taking the perspective of them as a protected child or a child to be empowered? Now, usually when I say this, people say, oh, I'm somewhere in between. And I think that's fair enough. But I really probe you and say to every person in the audience who's thinking about the digital space, where do you fall? Where is your own personal starting point? And it matters quite a bit because it plays a role in how we look at all of the data and all of the information that we get about young people today. It plays a role in the interpretations we make. It's not bad to be on the protected side or bad to be on the empowered side. It's just important to know where you fall. And I find this particularly important when I think about today, the digital space today. Children have digital rights. Everyone sitting in this audience today, I understand there's about 100 of you, all know this. We know that young people have digital rights. But when we look at the digital rights of young people, what we see right now, what most often happens is we focus on protection. Young people have three rights. They have a right to provision. They have a right to the skills that allow them to engage in the digital world. They have a right to protection. They have a right to be safe in the digital world. And they have a right to participation. They have a right to have a space to participate. And while I think places like Safer Internet Forum and others, we often really focus on the safety, the protection, as is warranted, there is a healthy dialogue to be had about recognizing it's not just the safe space we should be focusing on. It is within these spaces. How do we allow them facilitate participation? And how do we ensure that they have the skills, the provision to engage in this well? And I think that is what we're talking about today. I think the moment of the digital society that we are in now is recognizing it is not one of these three rights. It is all of these three rights. And it's our job to figure out how we make them really all be invested in. And in that regard, my question that I often ask, and I ask different places and spaces when I'm sort of talking about this is there a way that we can design a digital space that does both protection and empowerment, protection and provision? I believe we can. I believe there's absolutely a way for us to do this and do it well. But I also recognize that it's not easy. What I see happening is for us to be able to create spaces that allow us to ensure the space protects young people from the harms that are very real in there, but allows them to fully have the provisions to engage in the digital space that they need, we need to update our knowledge. We need to update our knowledge about young people and how they're affected by media. We need to update our knowledge about what's happening in the new media sphere and recognizing what we thought we knew might be wrong, and recognizing new and safe and empowering solutions. Now, given the time today, I can't get into all of them, but I do want to just briefly highlight what I mean by this very quickly. When I'm talking about user preferences and effects, and I'd be happy to speak more with anybody in the audience later about this in detail, this is my area of scholarship. What we know to be true so far, across history, when I look at vast amounts of media, is that age is the best predictor of media preference. So what you like, what you access, what you find in your home, for example, and what you use. Age matters most. Across every sort of factor, we have age matters most. And this holds true and is still holding true in the digital space. And this is one of these variables that we cannot forget when we're asking questions about how we provide for in this space. But what we also see that has changed in 20, 30, 40 years, and in the past recent years even, is the power of individual differences. More and more, what we see, digital media content is so bite-sized. It is so personalized that one size does not fit all. And when we're asking these questions, we need to recognize that many of the studies, many of the ideas, many of the philosophies we've had from the past will no longer work the same way because they were based on an assumption of mass. But now we are really looking at individual differences. We are looking at differences in development, cognitive, developmental, social. We're looking at differences in disposition, right? So we're looking specifically in how emotional differences or thinking differences, whether a child has a strong need for sensation or a strong need for information, that plays a very big role in what they like and how they respond to it. And also their social context. Are they growing up in a place and space that encourages dialogue about media or not? Are they growing up in an environment that's very low income? Are they growing up in an environment that's a high educational space? This information, what we now know with so many different types of media at their disposal, matters incredibly in helping us understand what they choose, what happens when they choose it in the moment, how they process it, and what it means for the long-term effects. We call this in science differential susceptibility to media effects. And I know this is sort of a mouthful. My students think so as well. But this really is capturing the idea that we need to recognize that in the digital society of today, the simplistic models of the past will no longer work. And that's something we all have to be open to accepting. I'd be happy to get into that more, but given time, I'll just hold that point and say that's one thing to keep in your mind. A second point I think that is crucial that we begin talking about is media creation. What do I mean by media creation? We need to do a better job of creating media content that actually facilitates provision, engagement in the space, not only safety in the space. Now, when I usually talk about this, I think of entertainment content. Now, I could talk a lot about educational content or informational content, but I'm first going to talk about entertainment content. And what I mean by entertainment content is that we have generally two types of content. We have content that you might consider hedonically motivated. This is content that is designed to bring young people joy. And on the counterpoint, we have content that we call eudaimonic, another term my students hate as well. And eudaimonic content is this content that helps young people think about life's meaning, truths. It's the content that maybe is not particularly happy, but maybe it's thoughtful, it's deep, it helps them reflect. Both of these forms of content are incredibly powerful in the lives of young people. And the digital space offers them the opportunities for both the joy and the reflection. This is true from traditional media to now the digital space. It gives them a chance to, the eudaimonic content helps them develop and grow. Whereas that less challenging hedonic content, the fun content, the enjoyable content, helps them when they're exhausted. It allows them to restore their resources. Both have a really powerful meaning in the lives of young people. And we know this to be true. And we know they seek out the digital space for it. But in the creating of content, whether you are interested in creating content that brings them joy or creating content that allows them to reflect, the digital space is making us reflect on what we can do today. Because now the digital space is diverse, it's fast, it's complex, it's personalized, it's immersive, and it's blurry. So when I sit there and I work with somebody who's creating media content and they say, I want to entertain a child by bringing them joy, or I want to entertain a teenager by getting them to reflect, but then they say they want to do it in a social media space, the game changes. Because what we thought we knew is different in many ways in the digital space. And my suggestion to people who study, work, and engage in this space is to, again, recognize and be sensitive to the fact that the digital society has changed things. What does it mean for creating in this space? Well, it means we need to be aware that this is different and we need to think of things differently. For example, short form content. All of us know about TikTok. And we all know how much young kids love TikTok these days, one of the fastest technological revolutions we've seen in recent years. TikTok is short content, very, very short, small bits. Theory would tell us that when you have a lot of repetition of the content, that this will have a very powerful effect because repetition aids flexible thinking. Now, the question is that true in this space? And how much is too much? I've been on some calls right now for some consulting that I do. And in one of the conversations I had, they showed me makeup contouring videos. So these were videos where young girls try to use their makeup in different ways to make their face look smaller. And it was possible that watching one video could lead you to watching 30 more of these videos. Now, some might say, yeah, but they were 30 videos, but it was only 15 seconds each. That's a very short amount of time. I don't have to worry about that effect. Others might say it might have been a short amount of time, quantity, but that's a lot of the same message over and over and over and over again with no breaks, no stopping cues. This is really concerning for young people. I don't know the answer to that question. But what I do know is that our general assumption of quantity having some indicator of effect is definitely being challenged by the short form content. And what I know to be true is that when somebody asks me, is 18 videos of makeup contouring video too much? My heart says yes, but I don't know the science yet. And I think this is where we need to be getting to, understanding that we cannot rest on what we know before, but rather we need to understand things are changing. In the same ways, if people ask me about the effect of a YouTube video, what people often forget is that YouTube videos come with comments. And what we know from research is that these comments actually change how much we like a video. The act of simply having a comment that says, I think this is a good video, changes how you watch it. None of our research prior to very recent years has even tackled this. If we want to understand how to create good content for young people in the digital space that protects them and engages them, we need to recognize our assumptions from the past may be wrong. And we need to be willing to ask and invest in answering the questions properly. And that means user-centered research, talking to young people directly, which I know you guys actually do quite a bit in Brazil, which I love. Tiago's work, some of my favorite. You need to really get into co-creation and in community engagement. Again, I can't think of a better place than Tiago's team on actually bringing community there. That's why we all love Tiago. He always shows us how we do this and how we bring community in. And you have to be willing to challenging the status quo and saying what we knew might be wrong today. And in doing this, we need to start thinking about key solutions. Solutions in my mind can go into multiple categories for which I could talk for hours about each of these. But I think some key things to keep in mind with solutions that I would suggest that I would love that people at CIF today are talking about and continue talking about are three areas. One, as we start saying, okay, yes, we know young people are different in the digital space and we need to get better at it. We need to recognize that they need skills on how to do this. They are not born knowing how to use the digital space. Despite the conversation that we have, oh, they're born into a digital world, they should be fine. They're not. None of us have been taught how to use this space and they all need help. I'm here in the Netherlands. I'm developing a project right now. I'm developing a scale and a set of training items and such called the DigIQ, your digital IQ, that looks at young people's ability to think strategically in the space. to think critically. Is it true or not? To think about netiquette. How do you engage with one another? To think about how do you create beautiful things in this space? The power of creativity in the digital world is incredible. How do we harness it? To help make sure that young people know what security and privacy looks like. To help make sure young people understand how to protect their health and well-being and find a balance so that they're not always connected. To know what it means to engage in green tech or sustainability. To know how to solve a problem when they're online. And to understand what artificial intelligence means and what it means for them. This is called digital competence, the skills and knowledge to thrive in today's society. It is our responsibility, I am certain of it, to make sure that young people have these skills, and we cannot assume that they are simply born into having these skills. Recently, I've been data collecting across the Netherlands with young people as young as 10 and as old as 110, trying to see how they fall on these skills. And you can see our youngest group here, which is highlighted in red. You can see quite a variety, right? The top bar here showed the kids tend to do best in the Netherlands right now, our young tweens and teens, in spaces of having strategic information skills. So knowing how to use the computer and also netiquette, knowing how to talk to one another. They're doing pretty well. But comparatively, spaces such as artificial intelligence, understanding what AI is doing, knowing how Netflix gives them information, for example, understanding the backbone to Siri and all of these technologies, they very much don't understand yet. As you see across the lifespan, basically none of us understand this actually. Leeftijd, sorry, this is a Dutch, sorry, I didn't realize the image was in Dutch. Leeftijd means age. So what we see here is a real concern happening. There's quite a variation in skills, and we see across the lifespan that there's a variation in these skills. And I am convinced that it is our responsibility in the digital society to ensure that young people have these skills. And that means multiple players at the table, schools, stakeholders, every single player that we can envision that's surrounding a young people, a person's life, being there together and saying, how do we work together to support these skills? I also think we have a responsibility from the media side when we are working with media companies, when we are talking about creating the digital space, to help them think what they can do to help young people. I often talk about the phrase stopping cues. Back in the day when we read a book and it was paper, the end of a chapter told us to stop. When we read a newspaper and we finished the page and we folded it because we knew we were done. When we watched a television show, there was a commercial that said it's timed up. The digital space offers no stopping cues. We just keep going and going and going. Young people need help, and media creators can build stopping cues in that say enough is enough in a way that doesn't make you feel like you are missing out. It can be normalized. We can allow, facilitate, support, and make normal the notion of solitude in young people's lives. We can make that a part of their dialogue too. And in fact, we should be. This is something I believe that media spaces can really be taking an active effort in. And lastly, we can keep having the conversations at places like Safer Internet Forum when we say, yes, protection matters. We want to find ways to protect young people in these spaces, but let's not forget that in doing so, we also should be helping them to have the skills and ability to engage in these protected spaces because they have a right to provision and protect participation too. And I think if we can find a way to not forget that moment, to not forget the provision and the participation, but remember that this is all part of a protected environment. If we can do that well, and if we can do that across context, if we can make sure that everyone at the table, from the parents at the table, to the school, to the media creators, to the public policy space, which is why I think forums like this are so important. If everybody can agree together, everybody's going to take a stake in it. Everybody's going to try to play in this game, and we're all going to do our part to do this. If so, my idealized, very optimistic heart tells me that we can actually create a space that supports youth in a meaningful way that protects and empowers. Now, I realize that was a very short keynote address because I had to cut my slides a bit with the delay today. But I hope that this inspired you a little bit. I hope that you got some ideas. My information is on the slides here, and I'll ask the conveners to please share this with everyone. I would be happy to have a larger dialogue with any of you in the audience. You can always follow up with me, and I'd be happy to talk more about this. But on that note, thank you so much for your time.
Thank you so much, Jessica. A lot of food for thought here. Thank you. Gente, bom dia. Agora um pouco mais calma, tudo bem? Ainda mais depois de tantas informações.
Good morning, everyone. Let me greet you. I am Alana Rizzo.
I am a journalist who talks about public policies at YouTube, and I am going to make a number of comments about what we heard. Well, Jessica had to speak somewhat fast because she had another commitment, but she has made really very good comments. As all speakers have said when we started, it's always a very good moment to reflect, exchange, and I hope you can enjoy our activities throughout the day. Jessica has brought a number of comments for our attention. And I would like really to make those points before we go into the next panel. First, the concept of protected children are empowered children. And those two concepts are connected with three digital rights that she showed us. So protection, which is a priority to everyone. At YouTube, protection is our zero really priority about everyone who uses our platform. Second pillar are the skills. How do we deal with media literacy, media education? How can we get prepared for the digital environment? As pointed out by her, we say, well, the children are digital. As you can see, I am an expectant mother here. And we think that just because they are born in this generation, they already have the skills. But no, it's part of the collaborative work. We as a society, as a civil society, we have to think about that we would like all of us to have to be able to navigate the digital world. And thirdly, participation. How can we prepare the scenario of participation? Children, adolescents, teachers, which is also a priority for us at YouTube. We want to give voice to everyone in our platform. It's an open platform, but giving voice to everyone and showing the world to that means a lot of responsibility. And this is why we have some specific policies for children and adolescents in our platforms. And we also have specific products, YouTube Kids, which is a different experience just focused on children. It goes through curatorship, verification. And we've recently created another product, which we called SUPEX, Supervised Experience, just addressing what Jessica has pointed out. Not all children and adolescents are the same. And this is why you have to have something in between the main YouTube and YouTube Kids. This supervised experience gives parents and guardians the possibility of selecting based on the knowledge they have about their children and what they would like their children to have access to, according to the profile of a family, because different families, different perspectives. To close, I would like to emphasize what an important opportunity this is. Jessica has shown some solutions, but it's not something that can be done by one single agent. No, we need collaboration to maintain safe online environment. Now, I would like to invite the members of the next panel. As we haven't had the Q&A session, Jessica has left her email. And of course, questions through the chat. I know there are people online through YouTube. Everything will be submitted for further discussion. We know it's a very important day today, but it is an ongoing discussion. It's just one day that will give rise to further forums for discussion. Let me now invite the participants of our next panel, the moderator about online safety challenge with new emerging technologies. We have Christine Hopers, who is general manager of CGI.br. She's going to be the moderator and invite our guest speakers. Thank you all very much.
Um, Good morning. I'm going to be the moderator of the next panel. It's going to be in English because then it's going to be easier. And as we are running out of time, I would like to invite them all to get ready to start. I'm going to ask Krake Puthong, who is a researcher of Five Rights. Then we're going to hear from Lilian Kariuki, executive director of Watoto Watch Network, followed by Verity McIntosh, who is a researcher from the UK on virtual reality.
Hi all, so this is the panel. I would like to invite Krake now to talk. So in this panel, we are going to talk about a safer online digital technologies. My specialty is more on security, and it's a pity that in Portuguese we don't have two different words because these are different concepts. And I work more on challenges for security of new technologies, and we know that there are a lot. Some of them can also impact safety, and especially child safety. So I think it's very good that we bring together the security and safety sides, because we need really, when we are designing new technologies, to think about a safer environment. And if you are thinking about safety online, you also need to think about problems that security could bring to safety online. So I think this is something we need to discuss. So Krake, thank you very much. The floor is yours.
Thank you. Thank you and good afternoon from London. So we'll be talking about the Digital Futures Commission, our by design approach to address not only the safety, online safety, but also to promote privacy, children's agency, sociality and creativity. So that links really nicely with what Jessica has talked about in the keynote. So before we go into the conversation about the by design approach, the Digital Futures Commission is an exciting research collaboration of unique organizations engage innovators, policymakers, regulators, academics, and civil society to unlock digital innovation in the interest of children and young people. So we look at the digital environment, how people interact within this environment through the lens of children's rights. Our research focuses on three key areas: play in the digital world, beneficial use of education data, and guidance for innovators. My presentation today is based mainly on the two key work streams, play and guidance for innovators. And So basically, we will begin today with the state of play for children in the digital environment today, and then what this trajectory of travel will look like for the metaverse if we continue in this direction. Then I will share with you our by design approach, our solution to reimagine a safer digital world built on children's rights. So was the digital world built for children and recognize their diverse requirements? Does today's digital environment respect children's rights? Sadly not. So you could see on our research here at Five Rights mentioned risky by design. The risky by design identifies the four elements of risks, online risks for children. So content, contact, conduct, and contract. So all of these features, for example, for content, so basically for content, recommendation is one of an example of content risk. And then you have the friend suggestion. That's another example of contact risk that children face. It's based on data processed from the users, their network, and then it profiles it and then makes the recommendation of who to contact, and often could be strangers. And then, but the most elusive risk is contract risk. And this we often see in in the form of loot boxes in games. The other research done by Five Rights, commissioned by Five Rights, also shows other voice content, contact, and conduct risks in relation to the avatars, as you can see on the slide here. Now, move fast forward to the full bloom of the metaverse. What could go right and what could go wrong? So the metaverse promises enriched three-dimensional and immersive experience seamlessly converging the physical and digital realities using various technologies, including artificial intelligence, augmented reality, virtual reality, extended reality, and so on and so on. These enriched experiences are not limited to the world of gaming and play. The metaverse can also be applied to education and bring joy and, enriched learning experience to children. But the risk that we talked about this contact risk, conduct and contract risks could also be amplified when the virtual world merges seamlessly with the physical world, as we can see in these headlines. So the moral, ethical, and even legal lines that vary from society to society are not effectively enforced in the physical environment, nor the digital environment, are likely to be exploited even further when the two worlds converge seamlessly in the metaverse. If it is now, just imagine, if it is now difficult to report sexual harassment or assault and get justice when that happens in real life now, how much more difficult would it be to report that you are virtually rape? As you could see in the screenshots and the slides here about the news, right? And that said, these emerging technologies are not going away. So rather than continuing to make the digital world and metaverse risky by design, we should make the digital environment and the metaverse child rights respecting by design. Why? Because child rights then is holistic, and therefore it encompasses safety. It takes account of safety, security, all the hygiene factors into consideration, without compromising on the other rights, such as privacy, freedom of expression, participation, and assembly. So one of our by design solutions is playful by design. And here we offer seven principles of playful by design. But before I go into the details of what these mean, let me recap on what we mean by the by design. So the idea of by design harnesses the generative power of design to embed the ethics and morality that we treasure in our lives, the constructive possibilities that help us humans flourish into and put that into digital innovation. In short, we advocate building technology right from the beginning, rather than retrofitting safety, privacy, security, ethics, and inclusion after the digital products and services hit the market and create the negative headlines. While the term by design puts a spotlight on designers, other stakeholders, including investors, policymakers, and regulators, also have a role to play in motivating the adoption of the by design solutions. Now, returning to the playful by design as one of our by design solutions. So we integrate what we refer to as the important things in children's lives that incorporate that into our playful by design principles, a solution based on children's ideas of free play. Essentially what that means is child-led play and indeed children's rights to play. Yes, that's right. Children do have the rights to play according to the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child. Now, how did we build these seven principles? We built them through the reviews of literature on the value of play to childhood, digital play. And then we also consulted children. So children are informing us. children in the UK about what they value about play and their playful experiences in the digital environment. We also conducted surveys about children's play experiences in the digital environment. And based on these efforts, we then derived seven principles that intersect children's right to play with safety, privacy, security, while also supporting children's agency. Each of these principles combine the qualities of play. So basically what children identify as being valuable to them and what the literature say, you know, as being valuable to childhood, and turn that into a goal. So this is the outcome we would like to see, and we intersect that with the digital the features of the common products and services that children say they are using. And so to help designers, we're not putting, you know, designers on the spotlight without giving them a tool, right? So to help the designers embed playful by design principles into their digital products and services, we've developed a card-based design tool with designers in, you know, across various countries and industries. And then, so our playful by design cards are available both in the physical forms as well as in the digital form. The cards include the principle cards and the prompt cards that help. The prompts are meant to help you designers narrow down or expand their design thinking into the different stages of their design processes. Our playful by design cards also come with playboards that allows designers to use the cards flexibly at different stages and focus on the questions or the design challenge that they would like to check in relation to the playful by design principles and the different features that underpin those. Now, ultimately, we at the Digital Futures Commission, we advocate child rights by design. So what do we mean by child rights by design, and how does that come about? So we are in the process of developing a comprehensive child rights by design toolkit, crunching down the 54 children's rights into 11 principles of child rights. So what this means for businesses is that to claim the label of child rights by design, businesses and innovators should incorporate the 11 principles of equity and diversity, should think about best interests of the child, and that should not be trumped by businesses' interests. Children's voices, age, and make sure that your work is age appropriate. Be responsible, align your work with existing policies, regulations, participation, privacy, safety, well-being, development and agency. Noting today's theme of Safer Internet Day, I would like to emphasize that in the digital environment, privacy is a cross-cutting right-based principle with very practical implications for design. So what it means is that you can't have online safety without privacy. Noting, for example, the content, contact, and conduct risk mentioned at the beginning of this talk, the good thing is that the lens of children's rights for design has captured all of these elements, be it safety, security, privacy, and more. That is why we at the Digital Futures Commission advances our playful by design into a bigger picture of child rights and provide questions for designers to ask themselves at different stages of their design, to remind themselves about the different elements manifest in the digital environment. And we will be launching this toolkit at the end of March this year. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. So before we pass to Lily Kariuki, I would just like to remind people that you can ask questions. So if you are here in the audience, please write your questions down and give them to one of the receptionists. And if you are online, you have the YouTube chat where you can send questions, and Rodrigo will be responsible for sending them to me. So Lily, if you are online, please, you're the next one, and the floor is yours.
Thank you so much. So greetings.
It's not working, so I cannot.
Thank you so much. Can you hear me now?
Yes, yes, we can hear you now. Thank you very much.
Okay, greetings from Kenya. So Jambo. My name is Lilian Kariuki, and I'm the founder and executive director for an organization called Watoto Watch Network, which our only and main focus is child online protection. And for the last 10 years, we have been running awareness programs in Kenya. And our awareness programs target children, parents, teachers, law enforcement, policymakers, and also the general public. And on top of that, we're also the coordinators of the Global Safer Internet Day Kenya. And I would say happy Safer Internet Day to everyone present. And for Kenya, we are organizing we are participating in the 10th edition of Safer Internet Day. So I want to jump in into a bit about Kenya. Kenya has a population of about 50 million people. And the internet connectivity in the population is about 42%. That is inclusive of both adults and children. And being that we run awareness programs, we get to go into schools a lot. And four of the main platforms that our Kenyan children are using right now, social media platforms. So Instagram is very popular, TikTok is also very popular, Snapchat and WhatsApp. And now to dive into the topic at hand. So we feel that there's a lot of development of content when it comes to child online protection resources. But where there's a miss is the aspect of implementation. So there's a development of content, but implementation is there's no plan towards it. So we are seeing a lot of social media platforms have very good safety resources, but how do they get to reach to the necessary or to the target groups? These are the children, the parents. So we feel that there needs to be four areas to be put into consideration. And one of the areas is there's always a talk of free online resources, but how free are these online resources? These children have to have some level of connectivity in terms of buying bundles or paying for internet service. So how free is this? Are these resources that we call free online resources? So some of the considerations, four of the considerations that we feel that need to be put, we need to put ourselves into task is one, there's the aspect of when content is being launched. I'll give an example of Kenya. It is launched in the city. So Nairobi is our capital city. And it does not get to children in the rural areas who are equally on the internet. So that is one consideration that needs to be put in place. If a resource is launched or put in place in an urban area, how does it get to the children also in the rural areas? Because all children deserve the right to information and safety information that at hand. Secondly, there is also need to look into the aspect of connectivity. So when you have these particular resources, our children will jump into the fun aspect of this social media site. They will not, once they get the bundles or the internet, they connect to the internet, they will not necessarily go directly to the safety resources that have been provided on these social media platforms. So there's a need of consideration on how to make this information, I would say, more interesting to the children, maybe be gamified, or just make it possible for them to reach it without having to go and look for it somewhere else, and for them to feel like they have to put in a lot of funds to actually go and learn about the safety aspect. Because when it comes to connectivity, I would say it's a bit low, because internet is pricey in our region. And if we are very keen in ensuring that children are safe on the internet, we must put this into consideration. How do we package this resource in a more affordable way and in a fun way for these children so that they feel they can actually spend the little pocket money they have been given to buy bundles and actually go and look or read through these particular resources? Thirdly, I'd want us to also consider the level of digital literacy. This has been such a big challenge to us as we're implementing programs on the ground, because the resources that we have are not do not consider the parent who has, you know, not gone to school. And these parents are the same people who are buying the gadgets for the children. So how best do we get the resources to for them to understand in simple ways so that they can be able to also support their children in what they're doing on the online space, and also for them to know how to reach for help when something happens and when their children seek for help from them. So there's an aspect of digital literacy that needs to be considered. And finally, one area we feel that it's a miss, but that is in our region, in Kenya. There's the assumption that we have organizations that are there or are already placed to offer victim support. And I want to say that this is not the case. And our ask would be this. Once, if the content is being developed, look into the aspect of also victim support. What other resources are for victim support? We only talk about the safety. But if for us, you know, as a country, we do not have those agencies that support a victim who's undergone any form of child online abuse, we are failing from that particular end. So my ask would be for the social media companies, if you know this is an issue, how much, if a country does not have an organization that can support this particular child, what other resources can you ensure that the kids can access besides, you know, not having that support from an NGO or a government agency? And on top of that, I want to also look on the bright side of things, and I want to highlight about some of the progress that we have made as a region and also as a country, because it's not always doom. I feel like we have come a long way. Some of the things I want to highlight is, one, Kenya has a child protection unit and a law enforcement. And I would say this is pretty new because it was opened in 2019. And this particular child protection unit is equipped with equipment to handle OXEA cases or child online abuse cases. And this is the first unit in Africa to be connected to the NECMEC cyber tip line. So that is a very, that is a plus for us as a country. And also it is the first country in Africa to be connected to the Interpol sexual registry. So that has also helped when it comes to offenders coming into a country for any sort of cases that they've undergone in other countries. So it makes it even harder for them to come into a country. So that is a plus for us. Also, we have a national plan of action by the Department of Children Services. So now, so the NPA 2022 to 2026, and we are hoping now that people will be able to encourage people to know that there's a direction that you're heading in sorting or handling matters child online safety as a country. So we also have a task force. So a task force where we meet every 3 months. And a task force is important because they are always emerging issues, even from our region, because we have a lot of we have a lot of traditions, a lot of cultures, we have a lot of tribes. Kenya, we have about 42 tribes and all speak in different languages. So even when it comes to child online cases, they manifest in different ways, especially cyberbullying. We get a lot of bullying from, you know, the different languages. And these are some of the things that the task force discuss. And the task force entails government agencies, NGOs, and law enforcement that meet annually to make progress on supporting children on the online space. And another progress that we've made also as a region, there has been an increase in research, not only in Kenya, but in Africa as a whole. So we have a recent research that was conducted by Interpol, ECPAT, and UNICEF that is called Disrupting Harm, that has looked deeper into the matters of OXEA, so online child sexual exploitation and abuse. And the research covered about 8 countries in Africa. So I'd want to encourage you to read, to go and read more about that and to find out how we are handling or where our status is in terms of Africa in handling child online cases, especially OXEA, online child sexual exploitation and abuse. And another win that we have currently is when it comes to policies and laws. So for a very long time, we have been struggling talking about issues such as our offenses, such as cyberbullying. We did not have a law that covers that. So we were only going into the schools or running awareness out of the good of telling people do not bully someone. So it was not criminal. So from in 2018, we got a law. So we have the Computer Misuse and Cyber Crimes Act that captures also children cases. So that is one of the laws. We have the Data Protection Act also now that has been enacted. We also have a new Children's Act. So now what is happening is every law that is being developed, we are ensuring that it has child online matters are incorporated in those particular aspects of the law. If it is a law that covers online or anything data related, we are ensuring that that is put in place as a country. And finally is about Safer Internet Day. Safer Internet Day, when we started out lobbying for organizations to take part in Safer Internet Day to raise awareness on child online protection as a country. In 2014, we had about just 14 organizations. And I'm glad to say as of last year, because this year we have not yet tallied, because the events are still ongoing today. So as of last year, we had about 32 organizations taking part in the events independently. So I'm glad to also mention that as much as we have a lot of challenges, we are also making progress as a country and also as a continent. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Lily. Thank you. Thank you for sharing the challenges that you have there. And I think a lot of these challenges we have here in Brazil as well. So I would like to call up Verity, and she's going to be our last panelist. And after she speaks, then we are going to open the floor for questions. So if you have questions, please write them up. So Verity, thank you very much, and the floor is yours.
Thank you so much for inviting me, and thank you to the other panelists.
Your mic, I think it's on mute.
Okay.
I cannot hear you.
Let's see. I can hear me. Can anyone else hear me?
Okay. Yes, yes. Now we can hear you. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you. Hola, bom dia. Thank you for inviting me to take part today. I'm going to be speaking to you very quickly about some research that we've been doing in the UK on this idea of safeguarding the metaverse. The word the metaverse has come up a few times today, and I think sometimes it's helpful to have a little bit of a way of understanding what do we mean when we say the metaverse. So for me, one of the easiest ways to understand it is to think about the internet as a sort of a continuum, as a historical document. So we started so long ago with this idea of web 1.0, where everything was just fixed, published content. We had web pages, they were published, we read them. They sometimes stayed up, they sometimes came down, but it was a very one-way transaction. And then I think what we've been talking about a lot already this morning is the transformation that happened in the digital realm when we moved into Web 2.0, which was much more of a mobile paradigm. So a lot more content was about social sharing, it was user generated, there was the ability to have two-way conversations through social media, and this absolutely transformed the way that we understood safety in the internet. For me, I think where we're heading now and all the symptoms of what we're seeing in the last sort of 5-6 years around tech investment is suggesting that we are heading towards this new paradigm for the internet that you might call Web 3.0 or Web 3, which is much more about moving on from this idea of content and thinking instead about user-generated activity and behavior, the idea that we might have social encounters with one another in a much more participatory way as we start to explore the internet. I heard someone recently refer to it as an unflattening of the internet, which I rather like. I don't know how that will translate into Portuguese, but this idea that we go from flat screens that draw much more on the kind of the book page paradigm and much more into a 3D immersive, rich, textured space that is more drawing from our everyday life, the way that we move within the world, the way that we connect with each other. So a much closer analog to the way that we behave in our physical lives, much more so than the way we behave when we're interacting with screens. So as has been suggested, there is a generation of young people who you could argue are effectively growing up with the metaverse, with these spatial dynamics as part of their normal everyday life. We're already seeing billions of daily users in games such as Fortnite and Roblox, which have a lot of the affordances that we're expecting the metaverse to also bring. So things like massively multiplayer spaces, persistent worlds, representation of yourself as an avatar, the purchase and trading of digital goods. These are all the kinds of things that we're expecting to proliferate as the internet moves into this more spatial generation. And so you could argue, as several have, that these young people are already used to this and that actually they are gaining the digital literacy through sessions like the ones that have been discussed today to be able to cope better with the metaverse than we might give them credit for. But I think one thing that I keep coming back to is that, yes, the metaverse is not just about virtual reality, but there is an awful lot of conversation about how virtual reality is going to transform our media experiences and our communication landscape. And virtual reality is different. For decades, psychologists and neuroscientists have been doing experiments to understand how we feel when we operate in virtual reality. And what we're finding again and again is that when you are entering into a virtual world using virtual reality technologies, it's a much more immersive experience. We feel present. We let go of the rectangular boundaries that we expect from our screen experiences because there are no boundaries. We are in the center of the world now. We are the center of the world. And we experience other people in that space as much more closely as we would experience them in real life. And with that comes some concerns. So in our report, we spoke to a number of different people, and Hannah from the National Society for Prevention of Cruelty to Children, which is the UK's leading charity for child safety, shared that one of the most particular concerns for her is the kind of sensory and immersive qualities of these products, and that these qualities provide new means for abuse. So it is different to Fortnite when we are thinking about these more embodied spaces, these places where we feel present and where our personal space can be violated or can be kind of predated upon. So when we were doing the research for this particular report that I'm mentioning called Safeguarding the Metaverse, myself and our team of researchers spent a lot of time in what you might call proto-metaverse spaces, so spaces that are the closest that we have now to what we might imagine this next generation of the internet to be. And so places like VR chat, like Facebook's, Meta's worlds, a number of things like alt space. So there are kind of apps that exist in virtual reality where mass audiences can participate at the same time and interact with each other. And we spent a good amount of time trying to understand what happened in these open spaces. And unfortunately, our observations from these spaces is that harassment and abuse was rife. We're not the only ones to make this discovery. There's been a number of pieces of investigative journalism and research around the world that suggest that one of the unfortunate behaviours that has emerged from these open, unregulated spaces is almost endemic levels of harassment and abuse of participants. So we're seeing instances of racist and homophobic language, transphobic language, simulated violence, simulated sex, non-consensual touch. And that this is particularly concerning when we find that age limitations, most VR headsets will say somewhere in the small print that no one under 13 should participate. But we're finding that invariably those age limitations are not effectively applied. There is a lack of information for caregivers, and so they're often not understood to be a consideration. We've seen many pictures already today of very small children in headsets as a fun and enjoyable way of experiencing these virtual worlds, whereas technically speaking, they shouldn't be in those places. So we are finding that these spaces are a little bit like allowing children into a public forum, a public square, with no teacher present, with no bouncer in the, with no door staff on the bar, and with no way of understanding who they will speak to and what will be said. So it's a challenging place to find a way of understanding these spaces as somewhere for the empowered child to feel safe and empowered. And we are starting to see evidence of criminal behaviour in these spaces. The chief executive of the Centre for Countering Digital Hate reported that the average participant in these spaces, not children particularly, just the average participant, can expect to be harassed or exposed to potentially harmful content every 7 minutes. So we are seeing something of a Wild West in these spaces that needs to be better considered. And last month, there was a quite high profile case in America of a 13-year-old boy who was being groomed for abuse by an older person whose mother had reported the concerns to the police, and she had confiscated his phone and taken him off Roblox, but they had managed to the abuser had managed to continue contact in a virtual social space called VR chat, and the mother had not been aware that that was something that could be done using the headset. So partly a lack of understanding about what these tools can do, and partly a lack of ability or understanding for law enforcement to be able to track predating behaviours across different platforms, is already causing us problems within these spaces. I'm going to skip over this bit because of time, but we can come back to how accountability works in these spaces if we'd like to in the Q&A. One of the things I wanted to just quickly flag is that at the moment, there's a lot of concern about behaviours in metaverse spaces, and how do we police behaviours, how do we monitor, how do we safeguard, how do we protect? One of the concerns that's less discussed at this point is a sort of a future concern that I think affects us all, and that is particularly with virtual reality as it's being designed at the moment. There is a vast capacity for the hardware and software that is used to do data profiling on a massive scale. When we look at some of the research around what can be deduced just from eye tracking, which is built into most virtual reality headsets, the researchers are making claims that you can use that gaze tracking, as we call it, eye tracking, to profile someone's gender, age, ethnicity, personality traits, drug consumption, fears, interests, sexual preferences. They suggest that it can be used to diagnose physical and mental health conditions. So just the way that your eyes move in response to stimuli is being suggested as this sort of incredible goldmine of data, which obviously makes it very appealing to data capitalists such as the big tech companies. It also makes it very appealing to governments who might be interested in profiling citizens in that way. What it certainly seems to do is breach the privacy of users. And I think one of the additional concerns when we think about Web 3 next to Web 2 is that it doesn't just breach the privacy of what you choose to do, it can breach the privacy of what you think. And so there's a question about neural rights and what our mental privacy means to us. Do we want our eyesight, the way that our eyes move, the way that we respond with our bodies, who we speak to, how we speak, do we want that data to be commonly owned, or do we have a right to mental privacy? I would suggest that we do. So what can we do now? I think immersive literacy has been discussed. I think we urgently need to find ways for parents, for educators, for policymakers, for law enforcement, for all stakeholders in this ecosystem to have an opportunity to try some of these tools and technologies firsthand. It's quite difficult to explain the sensation of being there in a virtual world if you haven't had an opportunity to do so. And following that, we need to really clearly designate who is going to be accountable in these spaces. I really appreciated Lily's point that actually the institutions are not necessarily there to pick up on problems or to create strategic responses or to hold accountable bodies accountable. So who are our accountable bodies within each civil society? And then we urgently need new and often updated legislation to understand that this is not quite the same as screen-based media, and it's not quite the same as in-person. So we need new legislation and regulation that will help us to support this empowered child. I really like the language from Jessica's work, to be able to feel empowered to behave as they would choose to in this space without being impeded, and certainly to be protected from abuse and exploitation, and certainly to have privacy and data rights established within the way that we connect with these new spaces. Thank you very much for the opportunity to speak with you. I'm going to come out so that we can have a conversation together.
Thank you very much, Verity. And while our other panelists open their cameras, I think a good summary of this conversation, I think it was very interesting because there were talks about us having better interfaces, and that goes for the people developing those software and those interfaces, that they need to understand the risks. So we were talking about the problems with costs and how actually to bring this technology to the people and children. That I think was also very interesting in Lily's presentation, and also that we need to have support for people to report abuse, and that goes also to the first speech, that we need have to ways to report, we need to separate a little bit the spaces. And I think you now kind of closed very good in a way that we are being more immersive, and that's more risky, and that always makes me think on that famous quote from Vint Cerf, that the technologist does a mirror of our society and all the problems that we have here. So I think this always is a challenge, but I think that the virtual realities, they really, I think, amplify everything on the internet. And this is something we need to think from a technical perspective, developing software perspective. And on top of all this complexity, we can have security problems, and we can have people abusing that information that are not necessarily people collecting that data. So I think this all makes everything more complex. And then I'm going to go for the first question. The first one will be to Lilian. She already opened. Yeah, they're all with cameras open here. So Lilian, there is a question from Luis Fernando that is, in the context of public policy, towards the digital inclusion. So how are those policies for digital citizenship and digital inclusion in your region in Kenya? So this is the question about public policies for digital inclusion and digital citizenship in schools, on how that's being taught in schools or talked about.
Thank you for the question. So I would say in terms of digital inclusion, and it is basically school-based. So the schools that are at more advantages are more of the international schools that are based in Kenya. But in terms of a policy that is coming from the government when it comes to dissemination of information, or right now I would say we have an NPA that now will allow us or enable us to reach out to other regions in a more systematic way. But it also that particular strategy or NPA is pretty open. So anyone would have to take it up upon themselves or an agency. But there's no, any enforcement or any plan in terms of a policy that says that this should be done, like if a resource is developed or launched. Is for this region and it needs to get to this particular region at this point. There's no plan or policy in regards to that as a country, but it is a school's initiative or an institution's initiative. And the advantage is now to the institutions that are able, the private schools, the international schools that are in the country. So children who go to the government schools will still miss out. So there's no policy in regards to them getting this particular information. Hope I've answered you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I have a second question here for Kruwaki and Verity. So I will ask Kruwaki to speak first and then Verity. And the question is about metaverse. So it's a question from Monica. And the question is if there exists any document or if you have any orientation or guide for educators on how to work with students in the metaverse.
That is a very interesting question. We, within the work that I do, we haven't yet developed such a guidance specific to the metaverse. However, we have been developing documents that are that break down the different type of risks that can be experienced, and these risks will also apply in the metaverse. So I've just shared in the chat here. Five Rights, a very own Risky by Design website that discuss the different types of risks and harm in relation to the very common features that we currently see and will be amplified in the metaverse. The other resource that could also be applied is, well, there are two. One is our Playful by Design toolkit. Although it is actually addressed to designers mainly, we have seen the use of the same toolkit by, let's say, people who rank games, online games, to reflect on the different aspects and dimensions of these games and make recommendations, both for users, parents and children included, and also for the designers, developers of the games for the next iteration. So that has also been shared in the chat. And the last one, which is more encompassing sort of resource and tool, is our Child Rights by Design toolkit, which will come out at the end of March this year. So then again, that links together how designers of digital technologies, metaverse included, could take into consideration privacy, data protection, security, safety, without compromising children's agency, their ability to participate, their ability to freely express their thoughts, and so on and so on. And most importantly, in relation to the safety, we would say focus on the privacy rights, because it affects, as I said in the conversation, you know, it affects the safety as well. So these are the three key resources, I could say.
Thank you. Thank you for your insight. So Verity, any thoughts?
Thank you. That was a great response. The only thing I would add perhaps is just to restate that the majority of certainly virtual reality enabled metaverse experiences are not designed for people, for young people under the age of 13. So we should be talking about 13 to 18 in education. There are numerous companies that are set up now to provide virtual reality experiences for lower age groups. And I would be cautious of those. And I would ask to see the research behind the rationale that those companies have for offering virtual reality experiences to younger age groups. They are very appealing, but we do not have sufficient understanding yet about how things like virtual reality affect younger people's quite sort of physical conditions around how their visual systems are still quite plastic at that stage, how their cognitive facilities are still quite plastic. There has been some early research to suggest that younger children particularly can find it quite difficult to differentiate between things they experience in virtual reality and things that they experience in the physical world. So there's some reasons to be cautious about educational metaverse experiences for younger people. But if we assume that we are talking about a slightly older age group, or that we've got some great research that tells us that it's okay, there are various different guidance opportunities from, particularly from the NSPCC in the UK. We're doing some work with them now. They've posted some recommendations for responsible use with young people that makes recommendations about duration of a session. They suggest that you shouldn't spend more than 15 minutes without a break in virtual reality, that you shouldn't exit from virtual reality quickly without a conversation about what's been going on. There are some recommendations for teachers about how you can use things like casting facilities so that you can see what the children are seeing whilst they're in virtual reality, so that it's not completely invisible to you whilst they're in the headsets. And to thinking about the duration of time you should leave between any kind of screen time, especially face-mounted screen time, and any kind of rest periods or food. So there are some recommendations that exist. Some of those are in the Safeguarding the Metaverse report that I mentioned earlier. We are actually, my co-author of that report, Catherine Allen, and I are currently working with NSPC to make a more specific report about children's experiences within the metaverse. So that will be coming out in the next couple of months, that will hopefully give some more specific and kind of research underpinned guidance about how this new platform or paradigm is going to empower younger people and how their rights need to be protected. But yeah, I would say approach with caution in an educational setting, and be particularly mindful of whether something is a closed app, i.e. it's something that you can anticipate, that is a fully designed and closed experience that you can send a young person into and know what they're going to do. Is it a 3D painting tool? Is it a story world? These can be wonderful. Be a little bit cautious about spaces that are effectively kind of open social spaces. Can you fully control who is in that space, or are there going to be avatars as people who are in that space that you don't know and that you don't have control over? So those are the things to watch for at the moment.
Thank you. So it's interesting in your reply that you bring another problem, that we need to educate the parents, because I think one of the major problems is that most technologies are thought to be 13 and older, and you see the parents introducing kids that are like 6, 7, 8. And I already know of people that are buying those glasses for kids that are very small. So I think this is also one of the challenges. That's not only educate in school, but educate the parents as well, that there are risks if you use the technology. So we are a little bit short on time, so I would ask you all to make some final comments. There was one question about a bill of rights or for Metaverse in the UK Parliament, but if you could be very brief, then I would start maybe with you to closing, and then I would go to Karaoke, as she had some comments as well, and then we go to Lily and we close the panel. So Verity, start with you. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Yeah, I think the question was about the UK's online safety bill, and I won't go into detail there because we're in Brazil, but also I think it's indicative of the fact that many, many governments around the world have started to really be quite positive in thinking about how their regulation and their legislation can be appropriate and can respond to these changes. I think many governments see the social media as something that happened before they had time to know what was happening and had time to regulate. And I think many governments are quite rightly seeing the metaverse as an opportunity to be more thoughtful earlier and to think about citizen rights before corporate profits. And I think that's a really positive sign. I think we've still got a really long way to go with those stakeholders understanding what's happening now and what we can expect in the future. So for those sorts of coming legislation and regulation frameworks to be appropriate, we need to all be working together to make sure that we are thinking what's happening now and what's happening next. But I am optimistic that the level of government and citizen engagement in this question of safeguarding and safety and empowerment is happening now, whilst it's still early enough to make change in the culture that develops from here.
Thank you. Karaoke, your final thoughts?
So, the question is about the online safety bill. I shall remark that it's still being fiercely debated in the parliament, and we do hope for more positive changes, a more holistic coverage and protection for children, and not just, you know, something that box them into a little safety corner in the digital world. But for what we see is that we can see that the bill is heavily focused on content risks, and sadly not so much the contact and conduct risks. Some bits touches on these and also the contract risks, but they're not extensive enough. And we do hope that with further iterations and lobbyist organizations and whatnot, it will be it will be strengthened, because currently as it stands, my personal perspective is that the content and conduct risks aspect is not very well covered in the bill.
Thank you very much. So Lily, some final thoughts?
So my final statement would be, child protection is everyone's responsibility, not just one agency, but everyone's responsibility. And we need to hold each other accountable, be it the telcos, be it the government, be it the CSOs, and we all work together towards child online protection. And this being Safer Internet Day, I want to say a big thank you to everybody who's been working towards protecting children on the online space. Thank you so much.
And thank you all very much for the panel.
Obrigado.
Bom, antes fazer um aviso aqui.
Well, some housekeeping messages. We are going to break now just for 10 minutes, and then we'll be back for several releases. So shall we break for 10 minutes, bio break, and we'll be back with Rodrigo. Thank you. See you soon. break. This is a time where we have a number of releases which focus citizenship and digital privacy. We have here a representative from CERT who will be responsible to release our guide and a new profile that we have over Instagram with a number of hints regarding best internet use. I also like to invite a sector representative who will also address some of those booklets. Miriam, after you both are done, I'm going to share some indicators, those that I had mentioned right in my opening session. Miriam, I hand over to you now. Thank you.
Hello. Oi. Obrigada. Bom, primeiramente gostaria de agradecer.
First of all, I'd like to thank for the invitation. I had an opportunity to participate at some previous editions as a panelist, not just as a moderator. Therefore, I feel so honored to be back.
Alô, agora foi. Especialmente nesse CID.
In this, my goal here is to introduce a new release addressing a positive and safer net. And how we make the best use of social networks, social media. This is a new version of a chapter addressing social media. This is an endeavor carried out by a number of players that work for CERT. And this time we have a new format, different language, different way to communicate that content, and somehow to show you what is the motivation that we have behind this chapter. You probably have a copy of this chapter addressing social media. So we kept social media, enjoy it with some moderation. Then we have some main hints and why. Why should I follow those principles? To follow something, to follow a guide, you have to be touched by that. And throughout motivation, we guess that it would be able to motivate people to better follow those principles addressed over the chapter. And for those who would like to get further information, we also make some additional description about that. In addition to that, we have another project which addresses citizens over the network. And for that, we have created a video which shows a safer use of internet during social media navigation. Social media chapter. This is a very important chapter because it has a number of versions. It was a first chapter which we have written our first presentation was a manual written like a book, but that was highly comprehensive. Therefore, we decided to release a smaller and thinner manuals. Social media was our first attempt. We started that back in 2012. Then we released another version in 2015 and one final one this year. And as an example of household ICTs and the best use of social media, some clues and hints for the best use of social media that is fully aligned to a high use of social media by our population. And that is a motivation. That chapter is a fifth of a work that we have been doing since last September that aims to create a new material to update what we already have in place. It started in September, and every single month there is something new. We updated what we understood by being mobile devices. That may be considered to be a new one, where we had two stages verification. Last December, we had some specific material addressing phishing. And now we have social media chapter. Anything which is produced, it works under a license that allows you to share. And then we count on your advertisement. The idea is to include your logo, your institutional logo, as part of the material, supporting us to communicate and convey that message. If you find that interesting, this is exactly the material. We just add your logo, you just send us an email, and then we are going to go back to you with this same very material, but in an online version. And in a more specific version, just for you to send it to a printer. And we do count on your help and support to promote our material. And we are also releasing today a new NIC.br profile. You are all invited to visit our new Instagram profile. This new profile will carry several other areas. So they have the portal Safe Internet, the manual. Everything will be encompassed over the same profile. The idea was to have our own channel where we could centralize all these ideas addressing security, safety, citizens online, some hints by cert.br. We have the Responsible Internet Project, a number of different initiatives which are now specific to that profile as a security hint. And now, thanks to one single channel, we hope we can better expand it and promote that idea where more people will be able to benefit from it.
material que foi postado, acho que foi na, na sexta-feira, a gente...
This is an example of a material published a while ago with some ideas about phishing, some tips and hints about phishing. We are just starting now with Instagram, but hopefully we are going to have that profile also available at other social medias. In accordance to how people will get that content. Well, that was my brief presentation. You are all invited to learn more about social media material. There is a QR code for those who would like to access it directly. There is URL. And follow our channel, internetsegura.br, and your contribution is key. So we can all reach as many people as possible. Thank you. That's it for now. My contact information, in case you have any additional questions, I'll be at your disposal. And if you want to get material, send us an email. We'll be able to fulfill your demands. Thank you.
Obrigado, Miriam. Parabéns pela...
Thank you. Wonderful new features. Congrats to you on your new launches. I would recommend that all of you follow it. Lucimara was our first follower. So that's great. Since then, we've been increasing the number of followers, and we need you. And well, I'm sure that after today, you've got a significant increase in followers. Morales, well, let me start by thanking the organizing committee. Just hold the video, please. Let me just explain what is Cidadão na Rede, citizen in the network. Thank you very much for the possibility to talk about that project. This is not the launch of the product, it's just a promotional video of it, because we launched it in 2020. What is the idea of this initiative? So how can you be a good citizen in the internet? Because a lot is said about the physical world. We know that we shouldn't throw waste on the floor. We shouldn't talk to strange people on the street. But then we go into the digital world and people do not know what to do. People do not sure of what to do, or maybe they feel overconfident, right? And think that maybe there is no risk whatsoever. It's not true. So just bringing knowledge to common citizens. So we explain, for example, that you should not place any waste or garbage in the network. For example, fake information. It turns into a snowball because it's disseminated, and then people would just follow and disseminate fake information. Or, for example, talking to strangers. So we always say, do not talk to strangers, but maybe it's common with social media and so on, but you know that whether the person is may cause any harm to you. So we have to be extra careful. Everything that we address in citizenship in the physical world is being transposed into the knowledge of virtual world. And then everyone can share their knowledge and can enjoy a better internet. So we created this project, and there are three main fronts. We have short 15-second videos. So we want to bring knowledge to common users. So 15-second video with direct information. You learn it just for looking in. You hear about all the different topics. We talk about internet infrastructure. where should you place the router at home, for example, some place into the closet and they don't know why the internet's not working. Well, there is no internet there. So we bring some information about network infrastructure. Then we talk about security, and CERT helps us a lot. So two-factor authentication, how to select good password to avoid really evasions. And we also count on the support of the legal department. I'll talk about the duties in the internet. For example, bullying, which is common in the physical world, but there is also cyberbullying, which is also present in the virtual world. So what should be done to avoid that and understand that it might not be simply a playful situation? Sometimes it's really an offense. And there are also some web pattern. To explain some things about web pattern and to use subtitles in videos, to be more inclusive and get to all different audiences, explain what cookies are. Everything is explained with the users. So the idea is to watch the video and learn something. They are very simple. Then there is another initiative. Teachers, instructors. Each video has a descriptive text that we expect people to read and replicate the knowledge, adding more information. So there is additional information if you are a multiplier. If you are a multiplier, you can use that at school, at home, whatever. And finally, you can also have customization. You can place a logo of your organization and become a multiplier of the videos. So you can place it in the social media, your own page, on Kitchen at Home, so that you can have knowledge about internet. And if everyone uses internet well, it's going to be better to everyone. And this is our methodology there. We have a promotional video that we are going to launch now, explaining how you can be multipliers. And this is what I'm going to show you today. The video that I'm going to show you shows four short videos about what I've explained. Then there is the new video that Miriam pointed out, social login, and then the promotional video. There are nearly 100 available, so you can just select the one that you prefer and replicate. If you are not an organization, do not want to add your video, that's fine. You can download it as a regular individual. So you can use WhatsApp, because there are different formats. You can add it to any different system. So let's see the video. Thank you.
Usar a internet de maneira eficiente.
Using internet efficiently, responsibly, and safely brings benefits to the society at large. But have you stopped to think how it could also positively impact your professional activities? Clients and users, which are better prepared, students who can have good and bad habits, aware citizens who are aware of their online rights. You can do it. Become a supporter of Cidadão na Rede. The main purpose is to disseminate best practices related to digital citizenship and good use of internet. We want the information to get as many people as possible. Join us. 15-second short videos that show a number of important hints about privacy, security, safety, appropriate online behavior, and others. Videos can be downloaded and shared with anyone and any organization for free. You can also ask for your logo to be included. Everything can be provided in your website or other channels. So providing full use of internet is everyone's role. So be part, NIC.br, Cidadão da Rede, and click on supporters. So this was my video. We have over 200 organizations supporting this project, disseminating them, and we would like to see more organizations including their logo and placing them on their social media, on, let's say, elevator screens, to employees, to clients, so that we can make internet safer to everyone. Thank you. That's great, Morales, and short videos, so it's great. People can share them easily. That's great. I'm just going to show you now the dashboard of Safernet Brazil with the data that has been announced today. You can access through indicador.safe.br. You're going to see it there. So we can see the balance for the year.
Bom, vamos lá. Aqui okay. Vocês podem.
Here you can select the type of content. There are 10 different categories. You have the general number here throughout all years, so all the history. And there you can see in the scroll bar, you can see the numbers for each and every year. Numbers change to reflect the number to that specific year. If you click on an year, you can see year to date, which started in 2017. This is an historical series that never stopped. It started 1st January 2016 and ended in December 22. In 2022, there were 193,000 anonymous reports involving 68,000 different pages. The pages were based in 71 different countries. Over 5,000 different domains. And the map does not apply exactly where the crime has occurred, but where the content was hosted. So it means that the contents were really reported. Most of the content is in Portuguese. You can see here about language. but they may be placed anywhere in the world, most of them hosted in the US and Ireland, which is a hub of data center and social media. And here you can see the numbers by type of content. If you click here, xenophobia, you can see the data related to that. Why has it grown so much? During the elections, and there is evidence here. Here we can see some aggregated curves. But you can simulate that later. In October, for example, during the election year month, there was a peak in number of reports. So xenophobia, not only discrimination and prejudice against foreigners, which is tends to be against Bolivian, Peruvian, and Venezuelan in Brazil, but also regional discrimination. So people from the northeast of Brazil, constant subject to discrimination, and people from the north. So hate, discrimination, prejudice against people such as me, who come from the northeast. Another category that deserves to be highlighted is misogyny, also related with the election period. So we're speaking against the rights of women. Same thing. October, with a peak of reports. So people speaking in favor of violence and discrimination against women. So you can see how the political discourse, the political comments impact the network, because the network is a mirror of society. It just reproduces what we all hear, especially resulting from this political polarization that we have all faced. So it helps us understand better the statistics once we see the number. Finally, there has been an increase in number of images of child abuse, we can see that in the indicators of the report units. There were 40,000 pages last year. And there was also an increase in number of cases seen in the helpline. Let me show them the helpline. So indicators.safenet.br. The other address is indicators. Here we can see another dashboard with data coming from the help channel. They are not reports, right? But children, adolescents, young people, educators, and others who came to the Safernet channel asking for help to deal with risk situations or in situation of violence that they were experiencing. The numbers of helpline were sustained throughout the year. The main problems are still related with inappropriate use of individual data, exposure of intimate images, shared without consent, fraud, and some other attempts of some sign of scam, bullying, discrimination, and mental health issues, including suicide ideation, self-mutilation, so issues concerning mental health. Even though the numbers remained stable, there was a significant increase of there was a significant increase in number of requests of disclosure of images, 120 as opposed to 51, so 72.8% increase. Most people were asking for help and support. They had received images of children and pre-adolescent in sexualized positions and just disclosed by influencers to describe this inappropriate conduct. But you see, this is wrong. Even though you don't like the content and you want to report the content, but do not disseminate. You cannot disseminate and in an attempt to avoid it from happening, because by sharing, you are enhancing and amplifying the image. So it's a crime in itself. And it is always a harm to the image of victims. So you are contributing to the scaling up of the process. So rather than sharing to show you feel really, you think it's unacceptable, so rather than do it, just make a report anonymously. There is no need to bring together your network of friends in the social media, giving more visibility or really exposing further the victims. SaferNet's team is here. We'll be here for the whole day. If you want to go over the data, if you have questions, if you want to talk more about these trends, Julian and I will be glad to help you. Rodrigo is also here, Guilherme, Manu, Anissa. Our team is here to help and to talk about that. Well, with that, I think that now we can break for lunch and get ready for our afternoon session. There are going to be two sessions in the afternoon, which are going to be amazing. We are going to resume at 2 o'clock with the session on digital citizenship and safety in basic education. And we have a very distinguished list of speakers.
Panel 2,
starting at 2. And we are going to start on time, especially because it's a hybrid event, so there are people watching us remotely. So panel 2, digital citizenship and safety in basic education curriculum. We are going to hear from Kelly Mendonça, VP of Education Programs of Common Sense Media from the US. Very interesting initiative. We are going to hear from Martin Felipe Cáceres Murri. He's executive director of the Center of Innovation, Ministry of Education in Chile. Mariana Cartacho, who's here with us. Thank you, Mariana. She's the director of the program Digital Access of the British Embassy in Brasilia. Rodrigo Nejan, the director of education of Safernet Brazil. And the moderator will be Alexandre Barbosa, who's here with us, manager of the Regional Center for Studies for Development of the Information Society, CITIC.br. We are also going to have a Q&A session. And immediately after, we are going to have a second wonderful panel.
discussing the new challenges around digital safety features. Our guests are Giovanna Ventri with Google Brazil, Thais Nifinega, Manager of Well-being for Meta Latin America, Dario Durigan, Public Policies Manager of WhatsApp in Brazil, Priscila Laterza, whom we heard today in the morning, Manager of Public Policies for Safety at TikTok, Bruno Farias, Business Information Security Officer of Vivo Telefonica, and Mariana Venancia, Legal Counselor for NIC.br. And Juliana Cunha with Safernet, Director of Special Projects, will be our moderator. And finally, to close, as our closing remark, we are going to hear from Adriano Cancian. Thank you very much, Professor Cancian. We are all delighted to have you here. Very well known by all of us, a very important leader in information security here in Brazil. He's a professor of the University of São Paulo and ACME Lab and Cybersecurity Research. So he's going to make our keynote, he'll be our keynote speaker, moderated by Demi Getchko. So see you all at 2 o'clock. Enjoy lunch. See you in the afternoon. Thank you.